But my biggest responsibility is to make sure you get your time's worth. And the reason I say that is because time is more valuable than money. In fact, you might start your notes with that. Time is more valuable than money. You can get more money, but unfortunately, you can't get more time. If somebody asks you to spend your money, that's pretty easy, right? We live in America. We're wealthy. So the money's not the problem. But what if somebody asks you to spend a day, right? You got to think that over carefully. And I know you did. I wouldn't waste one of my days, not for anybody, not for anything. Once I understood how valuable they were, I don't waste any. But to make an investment like today of your money and your time, I appreciate that. Today's gonna be costly for me. It's gonna cost me one of my days to be here, right? And some money, of course. But, you know, I don't need the money. I take the money, but I don't need the money. But guess what I do need? The time. So I'm here not to just joke with you. I'm here not to just tell some funny stories and give a performance and walk away. I'm here to give you some value, and I want to make it worth your time. I'm going to invest a day. You're going to invest a day. Let's get the most out of it and see what we can walk away with today. Anyway, for you that have not seen me before, just very briefly, let me just tell you my story. I grew up in Idaho, farm country, southwest corner of Idaho. In fact, my father still lives on the old homestead where I grew up. He'll be 89 his next birthday, still hasn't retired. I'm proud of my dad. He's never been ill. He's really something. I'm trying to get him to retire this year, 88. I'm telling my father, what a good year to retire when you're 88. And he says, hey, talk to me in 10 years, right? I might be ready. But anyway, I went to high school. I graduated. I went to college 1 year. Halfway through my second year of college, I decided I was smart enough, so I quit. One of my major mistakes. I should have stayed in school. But I thought, yeah, you know, I'm smart enough to get a job. That's what life's all about, right? Get a job, pay your bills, work hard, stay out of trouble, keep your fingers crossed, hope for the best. And I figured I was at least prepared to do that. So I quit college and went to work. A little while later, got married, got my little family going, and I'm out there doing what I thought was the best I could. But about age 25, I'm starting to struggle. I've purchased a little more than I can conveniently pay for on time. And the creditors are starting to call saying, hey, you told us the check was in the mail. What's the deal? And I'm getting embarrassed by that. I'm also embarrassed, big mouth me, with all the fancy promises I made to get married. I'm way behind on those promises. And I'm getting discouraged, wondering what to do. And I thought, well, maybe I should go back to school. Right, 1 year of college, pretty short on an application. But, you know, tough to go back to school, right? Especially when you got your family going. Time to stay is when you're there. So I discounted that. I thought, well, if I, you know, had my own business, that would be the way to go. But, you know, I'm short on money. Too much month at the end of the money. If you've ever been there, that's where I was, age 25. So I had to discount that. And I'm discouraged, wondering, where do I go from here? And then the miracle happened for me. Good fortune came my way. And who can explain good fortune? I don't know. Remarkable things that happen to you at a particular time. Sometimes it's just unexplainable how those things happen. One of my friends says, well, hey, things don't just happen. Things happen just. Another good note for your notes. Things don't just happen. Things happen just. And maybe that's it. I don't know. I'm an amateur on life, I guess, like most of us are, trying to figure it out, how to make it valuable. But I was ready. And my good fortune was, at age 25, I met a very wealthy man. His name was Mr. Schoaf, Mr. Earl Schoaf. A friend of mine had gone to work for him, and he started telling me about this man. He said, you got to meet this man I've gone to work for. He's wealthy, but he's easy to talk to. And he's got a unique philosophy of life. And the more he kept talking about this man, I thought, well, I've got to meet this man. So sure enough, shortly after that, I had a chance to meet this remarkable wealthy man, and I was impressed. He was wealthy. Sure enough, he was easy to talk to. I was so intrigued. Within a few minutes, I said to myself, if I could be like him, farm boy from Idaho, if I could be like him, I'd give anything. And then I thought, if I could just get around somebody like him, and if he would teach me what to do, I would be willing to learn. I'm coachable. And that was my good fortune. A few months later, this wealthy man that I met, Mr. Schoaf, took a liking to me, hired me, gave me a job. I went to work for him. And I spent the next 5 years in his employ. And then, unfortunately, he died at the end of that period, at age 49. His last 5 years, but the first 5 years of my new life, I got to spend with this remarkable man, and my dream came true. He coached me, he taught me. He taught me the books to read. He taught me the discipline. He taught me the changes to make in my language and personality. And the things he shared with me during that 5 years literally changed my life, turned my life around, changed my income, changed my bank account, changed my future, changed everything. I've never been the same since that unique experience. And I wish he was still alive today, Mr. Schoaf. I'm sure if he was alive today, especially after this seminar, Idaho farm boy makes it to Dallas-Fort Worth, full house, standing room only. Pretty awesome, I'm sure. If he was alive, I'd be calling him today saying, you won't believe what's happening to me. I've had a chance now to share with other people what you shared with me. But anyway, how I got here. 30 plus years ago, I was living in Beverly Hills, California. And one day, a friend of mine, businessman friend, said, Jim, I'd like to have you come and share your story with my service club that I belong to, the Rotary Club. He said, I know your story, Idaho farm boy makes it to Beverly Hills. But he said, I think my club members would love to hear your story. He said, if I arranged one of our breakfast meetings, would you come tell your story? Just share a few thoughts. I said, okay. So I agreed to go give this breakfast talk. And guess what? They liked it. And my telephone rang. I got another call saying, we heard you've given your story and shared some ideas. Would you come talk to our club? First thing I know, I'm starting to devote a piece of my business time to giving these talks. And then one day, a businessman who'd heard my talk, I think two or three times, approached me and said, would you come and share that story and some thoughts with my management and sales people? So I got this little company going. And he said, if you'd come tell your story to my organization, he said, I'd be happy to pay you. And I thought, wow, wouldn't that be something? So I agreed to go do it, and I got paid. Little did I know, another fortune was waiting for me to translate my ideas into talks and speeches and seminars. Now I've written some books. It's on cassette tape. Now I get to travel around the world. Last year I was in Japan and Israel, Spain, Mexico, Australia, New Zealand, France, Germany, Canada, and now Dallas, Fort Worth. So. Idaho farm boy gets to travel around the world and share his story, and here I am today. Anyway, it's almost too much for me to comprehend from where I started, raised in obscurity, in a little small farm community, and now to be here today is pretty awesome for me. So anyway, that's just a little bit about my story. My story is probably more intriguing for me than it is for you, but I wanted to hear it again, so I thought I would just, you know, bore you with it. Anyway, I don't ask you to be impressed today. I'm the one that's impressed from where I came from to have a chance. But that's the American dream, right? Come true. Chance to start from scratch, start from obscurity, start with pennies, start with nothing, and have a chance to transform your life, change your life, set your goals, and see what you can accomplish. So anyway, that's how I got here. And I'm just delighted that this day has arrived, and I truly want to make it valuable for you. Let's go to work. Here's what I hope you'll find out of this seminar today, for your notes. Here's what I hope you'll find. Number one, sincerity. Above all else today, I hope you'll find me sincere. Best place for people to start to communicate is sincerity on both sides. I'm sure you're sincere or you wouldn't be here today, right? To spend this kind of money, to spend this kind of time, roll up your sleeves today, go to work like I am, and get this message, you've got to be sincere. So I assume you're sincere. Now I want you to see me sincere. But I've got a good note for you to make. Sincerity is not a test of truth. Important note to make. Sincerity is not a test of truth. We must not make the mistake of saying he must be right, he's so sincere. That would be a mistake. And here's why. It's possible to be sincerely wrong. So we don't mistake sincerity for truth, right? Sincerity is only a test of sincerity. Truth has to yet be tested by truth, okay? But hopefully you will find me sincere and truthful.